Yeah, welcome to part two of my setup overview series. This is the one where I'm going to show you how everything is connected. Well, without further ado, let's start with the video inputs of the classic consoles. Here is the switch box for the composite video. So it's the NES / Famicom, the PC Engine, the 2600 and the 800 XL are connected to here. This one connects all the S-Video systems together, so the Nintendo 64, the Japanese one, does support S-Video. The C64, the 3DO and the CD32 all are connected to this one. And most of the systems I have support RGB video via a SCART interface, so I have quite a few SCART switch boxes. This one, this one, this one, and this one over there. And those are all connected together. This one takes all the inputs of the other SCART boxes, which in turn is connected to this little box right here. It's the FrameMeister. So if you don't have space in your setup for a CRT monitor, this is the best thing to get. It does a beautiful job on upscaling classic consoles. In fact, it's especially made for that job. So do yourself a favor, spend some dough, get the FrameMeister. And I have a few consoles left in the setup and that I use a component video. Unfortunately, the FrameMeister isn't the best in handling component video. So there's this device which I had left over from my old home cinema setup. It's the D-Video Edge Scaler. It's a home cinema scaler and it does a beautiful job on upscaling and converting high quality signals. So it takes the output from the FrameMeister and the output from my component consoles, the Xbox, the 360 and the Wii, and it takes the HDMI input from my or I should say the DVI input from my old Pentium 3 system. And this one also outputs audio and of course an HDMI signal which goes A into that monitor and B into the capture card of my capture PC. Unfortunately, HDMI supports digital audio and I can't really use that to plug in my mic or my other analog sources. So what I've done is a little trick. I've taken the digital audio of the D-Video Edge, convert it back to analog and use that into the mixing panel. And this one goes to speakers, to the monitor and to the capture card. So I use analog audio for capturing, but it has been converted from analog to digital, to digital, to analog again, and then back to digital in the computer, of course. So it's a bit of a botch, but yeah, what can you do? The upside of this all is that it all stays in place. I don't really have to unplug and replug things, so it keeps working. I can switch consoles to my heart's content. I don't have to muck about with the settings. So that is the connection system in a nutshell. One thing I will warn you though about, and that's that it's simply impossible to avoid an unbelievable mess of cables. You see a lot of cables. because devices take inputs from all sides, from the back, from the front. Yeah, I try to do it all in a neat and tidy way. You see the CDX, the cable goes from back to front. It's really on the side, the inputs on the side. It's just terrible crap. But okay, the video quality is there, so yeah, that's something I have to live with. No neat cabling solution here. Yeah, well, that's about it really. Oh, I forgot to tell you about the effect tracks. Of course, this one isn't connected to that setup over there. No, it isn't. It's a standalone system. Yep. So, this is part 2. Thanks for watching. I'm sure there will be a part 3 sometime in the future. Bye!